Good evening. Thursday, May 9th. This is a work session meeting of the Newburgh City Council. On Monday, the council is going to have two different presentations. One will be from the Newburgh Enlarged City School District regarding its capital bond and budget. And then our water department will be presenting about the lead line replacement program and all the great work they've been doing there. This evening, we have a presentation by the NAACP regarding all of their great work. Mr. Reynolds. Hold on.
No, he's right.
No, he's good. Right there.
He's correct.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Good evening.
First of all, I'd like to thank the Newburgh City Council for this opportunity to speak before you and explain the current priorities of my NAACP branch as it restructures itself. Our priorities or target issues involving race in the city of Newburgh revolve around two issues. They are the expansion of long-term career training leading to solid jobs and the miseducation of our young people, especially on the high school, as they prepare for lifelong careers to support their families. I will this evening only focus on the segregation or the lockout of folks of color from local trade unions as the Hudson Valley enjoys a construction boom. I have provided the council with factual information to substantiate my remarks. I would invite you to check it out very well. You have in your hands a listing of all the trade unions operating in the area, most of whom have absolutely no workers of color on their membership list. This issue, once addressed and corrected, would provide a revitalizing economic shock to folks of inner city Newburgh currently unemployed or those seeking long-term career training. We would be taking a page from the example of President FDR during the Great Depression in this country leading up to World War II. The notion that our young folks cannot handle high-end construction technology is as false as the notion that the Tuskegee pilots could not fly airplanes during World War II. We all drive past these ongoing construction projects, pass over the Newburgh Beacon Bridge every day, and see no workers of color at any time, but we all remain silent. In 1954, when Rosa Parks refused to give up her seat on the bus, blacks were paying the same car fare, but restricted to the back of the bus. I remind you that her local NAACP branch in Montgomery, Alabama, bailed her out of jail. Today, in the Hudson Valley, the construction bus of opportunity and gainful employment is passing us by each and every day as we blacks and Latinos stand idle on the curb. This is the Rosa Parks issue of the time. To correct this issue in the near future, we will need your support, your financial investment, in the planned meetings that we have scheduled with the trade union officials. Providing our high school students with knowledge of the advantages of trade union opportunities will encourage many of them to remain in school and concentrate on their academic work. Once again, I thank you for your time this evening and cordially invite you to attend our NAACP session this coming Saturday. A flyer is enclosed in your information package. Thank you kindly.
Mr. Caesar, Mr. Rayner, if we may ask you a few questions.
I would entertain any questions, but I'd like to have the rest of the exec board come forward to assist me with questions, please.
Okay. So this is definitely, first of all, thank you for being here. Thank you for presenting this very significant information regarding employment and regarding construction employment for and opportunities for people of color. This is definitely high on my radar as the mayor of the city of Newburgh, and meaningful employment, workforce development, job training. There are some projects that are ongoing that we are partnering with REPCO, with Black Vanilla Community and Education Foundation, and other entities, non-for-profit entities in the city of Newburgh, who are specifically targeting residents to be employed and trained and so on. So there are some initiatives that are ongoing currently. One of the conversations, I've had a number of meetings and phone conversations with some of these local union presidents and leaders, particularly Todd DiOrio of the Local 17. He and I have met on a number of occasions, and we're constantly saying, why can't you hire and train for the apprentice program? Now there's a pre-apprentice program that's just starting up with Local 17 to accept and train people of color from the city of Newburgh. And a lot of times the feedback that I get when I'm in these meetings and these conversations and conference calls is that city of Newburgh residents don't have adequate transportation. They don't have adequate transportation, so when Todd DiOrio of Local 17 or the folks from Local 417 and other trade unions in the area hire Newburgh residents, particularly people of color, as long as the work sites are here in the city of Newburgh, they get to the job sites. But it could be 6 months in the city of Newburgh, but then Todd said he'll have another job and contract for Monticello, West New York, Sullivan County, and the city of Newburgh residents can't get to and from work with reliable transportation. We had another, we had two forums at Bishop Woody's Church, and a lot of it was centered around meaningful employment, workforce development, jobs for people of color, particularly African Americans, in the city of Newburgh at Bishop Woody's Church. And the main thing that came about from those meetings was transportation to and from the work sites. Then I suggested, and it's on film, that somebody in the African American community should think about in an entrepreneurial way of creating a van service or bus, some sort of van service or transportation service in the Black community to help some of our residents get to and fro these types of work sites. Because we see, I see it all the time with among the Latino or Latinx community. They have vans, they got transportation, and I see them, they go to New York City, they go to the different job sites. When I go to work at 6:30 in the morning, I'm at the Dairy Mart here on North Street, and the vans pull up, and everybody gets out that are Latinos, and they get their breakfast and their coffee, and they get back on that van, and they go to their sites. So there's something off in the Black community from my worldview as an African-American man myself. When I look at the Hispanics getting their transportation things together, but nobody's coming together in an entrepreneurial way to create transportation, because that's the one and single excuse, I don't want to say excuse, but it's the only comeback that Mr. Todd DiOrio, who I respect very much because we've worked together over the years since I've been on the council, with getting folks of color into his apprentice program, paid apprentice program. One African American young man was a former student of mine. He got into the apprentice program. He's working on the, it used to be the Tappan Zee Bridge, which is a multi-million dollar project that's been going on for a number of years. So we've helped bridge some of those opportunities within the community here. But the main thing Todd and other leaders in the trade union say to me is, the Black folk that we train can't get to. He said some of the guys come to the interview and they pull up in a taxi cab. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And he said right away when a young man comes to apply for the paid apprentice program, mm-hmm. and he pulls up to local 17 on Little Red Road, he said we see them, we're looking out the window, and they pull up in a taxi cab. We already know he doesn't have reliable transportation. So that's a piece that I want to add to the dialogue. That's a piece that we really got to try to figure out, because if we can get somebody in an entrepreneurial way to create that same or similar situation that the Latinos have with their van services, then we can really get people to work.
Yeah.
Yeah. I'd like to respond and say that the NAACP branch understands all these problems. We've heard them before.
Right.
Our philosophy is this time around, no excuses.
Right.
If Dr. King in 1954 could organize the Montgomery bus boycott, in which those who had cars provided transportation for those who did not, this is something that we should be able to figure out.
Exactly.
And I would add to it, not only are we talking transportation, but we need to be able to provide a healthy breakfast for these folk as well. So when they get to the job site, they're prepared to do, you know, the heavy duty work that has to be done and so forth and so on. So I think you're absolutely right. We need to sit down, look at what the problems are going in so that we have solutions in place so that these people can be successful. I just want to add that my approach to the unions now is that they have to invest in the education of Newburgh. You see, you know, they have to have a turnaround of thought that helping those who don't have helps us all. So I'm going to be approaching them not from an adversarial position, not from throwing rocks at them and them throwing rocks at us. We all in Newburgh now have to approach this situation from the standpoint of what it takes to make Newburgh better.
Let's understand that most of these projects or these trade unions, they're getting state and federal money for these here projects. Some of that should be offset for those issues. They just can't keep saying that, you know, people of color are not able to get there because of lack of transportation, when the money should be budgeted into that project so that that could be, so that the individuals can get there. We can't just keep saying that. I'm sure, you know, you can go there next year and they'll say the same thing. So what are they doing about it? Because they're getting money to produce. So we need to let them know, look, we can bring the bodies, but what part are you gonna do? And obviously they're not doing their part. So we have to let them know, these young men and women live in Newburgh, and yes, they may not have transportation to get there, but when you get a $30 million project or a $20 million project, somewhere in there should be a point where we will provide transportation for these young men and women. We will provide meals for these young men and women because they're underprivileged. And if we're going to talk about making this a better city, then we have to step up to the plate and let them know that business as usual is over.
So then at what point do you see the workers have an accountability and responsibility for themselves? I just mentioned the operative word, which is entrepreneurship. Here's an opportunity for the black community to be entrepreneurs. We know about Tulsa. We know about Rosewood. We know about the history of African Americans in this country. I teach it every day. So at what point do we pull ourselves up from our bootstraps, in a sense, and see this as an opportunity instead of asking for a handout? We can't ask the trade unions to say, you gotta provide transportation because these folks are underprivileged and these folks are in this inner city and they don't have this. Come on. Now, at some point, because in those closed door conversations, they're looking at me like, we're not providing transportation for no one. We're not feeding no one.
But sir, the law says there's a certain amount of minorities should be in each one of those projects.
Now, I agree with you on that.
The other thing is, if I'm not mistaken, over 100 students dropped out of school last year. So we can't keep pushing this under the rug, and I don't believe we're looking at for no handout. We're going there with a reasonable plan, so it's a win-win for everyone. We keep talking about the hand. That's not a handout, because you're getting the services of young men and women who will be upcoming citizens in the city.
Right.
So let's not keep saying we're doing a handout.
But to the expectation, hold on, Councilman Grassley, because I'm trying to be clear about this. The expectation is that a trade union, Local 17, Local 417, or whatever, is going to provide transportation and breakfast for folk. That is unrealistic, and I'm telling you, I've been in those rooms. Well, what I'm suggesting is, hold on, sir. Hold on, hold on. Yield, sir. Hold on. Let me finish my thought. What I'm saying is there's an opportunity in the black community for folks to come together, bring their financial resources together, and establish a transportation company or organization or company, a corporation, a private sole proprietorship, and provide that service that's lacking. That's the reason why we can't get people of color, particularly African Americans, to these sites and where they need to go. Because I'm telling you, the Latinos are doing it. It's not an issue for them. They're here in the same city with us. I see the van picking people up at Broadway and Mill Street. I see the van picking people up in the Heights where I live. I see the van, and I'm saying, well, how are they organizing the transportation? And they got 20 and 30 people per, like 20 people per van going to these job sites. So, you know, and there's one way we can look and say, hey, the trade unions are going to provide this, but I'm being very frank. I don't believe they're going to do that, but it's an opportunity for us to come together, and I will be a part of that solution and saying somebody in the community, even if it's the churches, even if it's Bishop Woody or a group of pastors saying, hey, listen, we're going to create this van service so we can get these folks to their job sites.
Okay. Thank you. So for full disclosure, I do want to mention that Cesar Raynor, along with Mayor Harvey, we are fraternal brothers. We are members of Alpha Phi Alpha Fraternity Incorporated, the local chapter, Kappa Upsilon Lambda. I am very proud that I helped Brother Cesar Raynor in his vie for presidency of the NAACP. I am an NAACP member, as many of us here at this table are. And I do work very closely with him still. So, I'm looking forward to his recruitment that he's doing Saturday. Also, to that point, so I didn't ask Brother Raynor what to speak about tonight. You know, it was a surprise to me as well, but I'm very happy that he chose this as a subject. But also to that point, I have to call him Brother Raynor, so I apologize to anyone else. But Brother Raynor and I have talked about the Transportation Committee, well, transportation, because as you know, we have the Transportation Advisory Committee. And one of those things that him and I talked about was the 511 ride share with a Mr. Liu, that the transportation, I see a member here, that we've been working with very closely on, and some other things. And so while Mr. Raynor only presented this, he does have a 10-point plan, and that is very, very inclusive. So I would encourage anyone to please contact the NAACP with Brother Cesar Raynor to really find out more in depth of what he's trying to do there. Yes.
Yes, it was impressed upon me all week long that I only had 10 minutes. So I wanted to respect that and make sure that my remarks fell within that 10-minute guideline.
Thank you.
Are there any other comments or questions from the council?
Yeah, I just want to mention that, this is much-needed service, and I have to agree with the mayor. You know, perhaps you can get together with the churches or create a subcommittee to discuss this issue of, you know, maybe pulling money together, purchasing a van, and providing transportation somehow. I mean, I think it can be done, right? Because we see that it is being done in our community. And I'd be happy to work with you if I can, wherever I can, reach out to folks that I know. So
okay,
it sounds like it's an ongoing discussion. Thanks.
Yeah, and just really quickly, to add to that, I met with Mr. Harry Poor. I've been meeting with Councilman Grice and the Transportation Committee, Advisory Committee, that's been working diligently. And I've met with our state representative, Senator James Skoufis, and we're working very diligently on revamping the entire transportation system in the city of Newburgh, which is gonna help to some extent. But then you have these work sites, these construction work sites that are, like I said, in remote areas that our buses may not be able to get to, you know? And that's where the concern is for these local union representatives and trade unions.
Yes, let me add one thing. At the we met with the union out in the town of Newburgh at the laborers union. They clearly recognized the difficulty with transportation, and he said one of his first steps for the pre-apprenticeship program that was funded by the state, with the strong requirement to hire from the city of Newburgh, was there's plenty of jobs in lead abatement, asbestos abatement, and it's all being done in the city of Newburgh. And his first goal was to place these pre-apprentice folks in the city of Newburgh so transportation wouldn't be that much of an issue. And after completion of the program, with the monies they earn, they may be able to afford transportation then.
Okay, thank you.
Right.
I do have a question. I do know that Labor Ready had something of which they would take a portion of their salary out for transportation. So that could be some discussion you may have with these unions. If Labor Ready did it, why can't any other service do it?
Okay, thank you.
I mean, as an entrepreneur, I'm more than willing to do this. My thing is, the unions, because, you know, talking to the unions, they, you know, I mean, they send this to the politicians, but when we go there, it's a totally different ball game when we talking about hiring people of color. Because, you know, I could buy a van. The van ain't going to be the problem. The problem going to be is hiring the people from the city of Newburgh, people of color, and keeping them on the job instead of putting them in positions to fail. Mm-hmm. So that's the problem we've been having with the union. It ain't so much of as, you know what they say to you, it's what they say to us when we go there.
Well,
it's a different conversation. That's why we need the backings of the city of Newburgh to go with us to these meetings so that what they say, that now as a city, we can hold them accountable.
And let me.
Well, maybe, Ray, one of the things is maybe if we started on the other spectrum, because I've been a member of the NAACP for like a long, long time. And I've seen the issues in this city. And also, if we started with maybe getting the van, let's get the transportation first, and then the people that want to work, because there's a lot of them out there that want to work, and they're afraid that they're not going to get hired by the union. But if we say, well, we have the transportation in place for you, and I'm willing to help you with that, you know that. But that's what I think we need to do, get the transportation in place first, and the people will come.
Now, what I also, there's two things, Ray, I want to share with all of you guys. Number one, we're in ongoing dialogue with these trade unions, and I'm willing personally to go with any one of you or all three of you to sit down with these folks so that we're all on the same page. That's number one. Let's do that. Let's set up an appointment. We'll line up everybody's availability, and we'll go out to sit with Todd. We'll go out and sit with Local 417 or any other. We can go to Brooklyn together. I'll ride the train, drive, we'll carpool, we'll go to Brooklyn, wherever. The second thing is, Jason Morris will tell you, we had a contractor, okay, who did not comply with that minority federal requirement. And he and I and our city manager were going, and our corporate counsel, because I had to loop in Michelle Kelson, we were going back and forth and back and forth with a contractor. I believe he was from New Jersey. They were involved with our water sewer separation after we got this, I think it was an $8 million bond. And we had all this money to get to hire these contractors to assist us in the water sewer separation. And this one contractor refused to hire and fulfill the minimum quota for minorities, particularly from the city. And that contractor, still to this day, I don't believe got paid. And there was legal stuff going on. So a lot of stuff happens on behind the scenes that the public doesn't know directly. But I can say that for a fact because I had to call Jason Morris, our you know, superintendent of engineers. I had a city manager, our corporate counselor, and say, hey, this guy keeps bugging me about his check. He did the contracting work. The other piece is when we talk about transportation and money, I'm in direct conversation with the Hudson Heritage Federal Credit Union, and this is a very important piece for the NAACP to know. They have a new designation, and they have recently contacted my office a few months ago and asked for a support letter because now they're going to be servicing low-income communities, particularly Newburgh, because that's where Hudson Heritage Federal Credit Union started. It's still here. People forget about that bank. When all the banks were running out of the city of Newburgh, the Hudson Heritage stayed here. They're right off of Little Britain Road, and that's in the city limits too, by the way. It's not in the town, and people forgot about them. Their new designation with servicing low-income communities, they're waiting on a grant, a federal grant, then they'll know by August. Okay, and this federal grant will provide banking products not only for low-income individuals, car loans, bank loans, personal loans, credit seminars, how to fix your credit, home mortgages, but there's an opportunity for low-income folk to create a business, a sole proprietorship, partnership, or a corporation, and apply for bank loans through Hudson Heritage Federal Credit Union once they get this grant, hopefully by August. And then you got some seed money to get these vans. Mm-hmm. So please keep that in mind. We're in direct communication with this bank, Federal Credit Union, so that some of these things can come to fruition.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you
all. Yes.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
The next item that we will be presenting on this evening is the 2019 assessment roll.
Good evening. Okay, I think you have packets. Eliana did packets for you. Okay.
Thank you.
Yep. Hi, and some of the information was sent to you last week already, but I updated and gave you a little more data here. So what I wanted to do is kind of just start with the assessor's calendar, because I think that puts a lot of things into perspective. And the calendar is what is
I'm sorry. Are we putting it on the, just so everybody can
yeah.
see?
Yeah, she has the PowerPoint. Thanks.
Thank you.
So the calendar is what's prescribed by New York State real property tax law. And everything that we do in the assessor's office is pretty much regulated by New York State real property tax law, whether it's the assessments, the methodology, the calendar that we're using, the exemption administration. the way sales are transfers are handled, it's all prescribed by state law. So when we look at the calendar, it pretty much begins and ends on July 1st. July 1 of 2018, we finalized the 2018 roll, and then that became the day that was our valuation date for our 2019 roll. So we're looking at values as of July 1, 2018. And then we fast forward to March 1st, and we look at taxable status date. And what that means is we're looking at the condition of the property on March 1. So if we take a property that's, say, fully renovated by March 1, we go back to July 1 of last year and say, what would it have sold for at that time? If it's a property that was demoed or maybe it's just vacant land, then that's what we're looking at. Ilion, I think I have my PowerPoint on a flash drive. Would that be better?
I'm sorry, we're experiencing little difficulties. We'll also be sure to post the presentation on the website tomorrow. Hopefully, we'll be able to overcome the issues we're facing right now.
So I'm just going to keep moving forward. So we look at March 1st condition based on a value of July 1 last year, and then we file our tentative roll. May 1st, the roll was filed. It was published on our website. We have the books in our office. And letters were sent to every property owner with their tentative assessment. That puts the taxpayer on notice that they have an opportunity to dispute their value if they feel that it's not fair. And that brings us to Grievance Day, which is the fourth Tuesday in May. That would be their opportunity to file their grievance. Once the Board of Assessment Review makes their determination, we receive their values back, their determinations. We make changes to the assessment roll, and then we have the final assessment roll, and that's published on July 1st. We still can't get the PowerPoint.
It's okay.
It's not coming up on the flash drive? No. I'm sorry.
It's okay. Please continue. It's fine.
Okay. So we're going to talk about assessments. Assessments are based on market value. A market value is the price that a property would sell for in the real estate market under normal conditions. That would be an arm's length sale. Normal conditions do not include foreclosures, city-owned properties, divorces, estates. These are more of a situation where people may be working or selling or buying under undue duress or pressure. So those are not considered arm's length sales. We take the arm's length sales, and that's what we're measuring, and that's what we're basing our values on, market value. The real estate market is always changing. It changes from year to year. It changes throughout the year. And when it changes, not everything changes at the same rate. So different types of properties will change at a different pace than other types of properties. Different neighborhoods will vary. Some neighborhoods are increasing values at a greater rate than other neighborhoods are. In the past, neighborhoods were reducing at a greater rate than other neighborhoods. Right now, fortunately, we're seeing a positive real estate market. The market's changing, and it's being reflected in the assessments. The other thing I wanted to point out is that two properties that are identical in style or square footage, they may have different condition or different other amenities that would affect the value. So you can have two homes side by side that won't have the same value, even though they're a similar type of house, one may be in better condition than the other. And of course, that's reflected in the value.
So, Joanne, let's say, for example, what you were just describing, two sister houses next to each other, they're brownstones. One is a one family, the other is a two family, right? So the one family has been recently renovated, the two family has not. The owner doesn't live there, it's a rental property. So would the assessed value on the single family would obviously be higher than the two family? Is that correct?
Well, based on condition, it could be higher, but also based on the property class. A single family house is typically going to have a higher value than the two family home. So it's not just that the two houses next to each other, it's the property class, the style, the condition, the square footage, the property size. It's all of the things that the market would relate to. You have a different market for a single family home than you do for a two family or a three family home.
Yeah, and I just want to also add, because all the council members and, you know, myself, we all received an abundance of calls when those assessments went out. I received my assessment, obviously, as a homeowner. And what people don't realize, when you're revitalizing a city, when you look at the economic elements nationwide with what's happening, you know, with 3.2% in the GDP growth in the first quarter of the fiscal year, and you're looking at just the way things are in the real estate climate in general, particularly in Newburgh, crime being down, there's a lot of elements that are that's turning the real estate market in the city of Newburgh really quickly. I had a woman who came to me and said, my taxes went up $500, and, you know, and she couldn't, and I said, well, we went under the 2% tax cap with our budget, so it's not because of what we've done with the budget. And I said, you know, that 2% tax cap is super important for us to stay under for the STAR grant and for other state and federal grants that you know, we would be eligible for. So with that being said, I said, bring in your paperwork. And when she brought it, she has two homes, investment properties, by the way, on Bush Avenue in what we call the East End of the city of Newburgh. And I looked at her assessment, her paperwork, and I said, you gained $60,000 in property value. The market changed where your homes increased in value, and that's what people want.
Right.
Because now you have more equity in your home. So if people don't understand real estate, and that's why I'm so happy you're here, if you got a $60,000 increase in your property value, there's more equity in the home, your assessment is going to be assessed higher according to the market. And that's a good thing, even though the tax liability went up $500, but look at how much more equity you have in your home. In the event you wanted to borrow against the equity.
Sure. Or if she were to sell the home, she would get more. I've
she
had people come to my office. They only wanted to understand the process. And when we talked about it, I said, how much do you think your home is worth? They said, I think I would sell it for more than it's assessed for.
Mm-hmm. And we're at 100% value.
And we're at 100%.
We're at 100% value.
Had a broker say that they felt that the values were conservative. So,
right.
So people are scared because they're seeing the assessments go up, but it's not a bad thing.
It's a good thing.
Good thing.
No, it's not.
It's a positive.
And Joanne, clear up one thing right now for everybody, please, because I've been reading things which really annoy me, and it says that the city council sets the tax rates. Please clear that up first.
Well,
right,
we're going to talk about that.
Okay. But all you got to do is Google it and see that's not true, if you want to take the time to do that rather than put it out there like that. But we do not control the tax rates.
But Joanne. And I want this point of clarification, and I'll be quiet. I'll shut up. If people look at the real estate market in 2008, 2009, when we had the worst economic crisis because of the housing issues, the predatory lending, and so on and so forth, if you look at many of us between 2008, 2009, all the way up to 2015, we're underwater in our property values and what we owed in terms of mortgage. We were underwater. So my property value went from at its highest point in 2007 at $255,000 for a single family ranch. Okay? It went to $96,000.
Mm, yeah.
So I had to get out of those loans. And so 96,000, and it's just now going back, I think it's up at to 140,000 at this point in time.
And that's a good thing.
And that's a good thing. It's not at the 255, but it is at least, it's been going up, and people don't realize and understand real estate.
Yeah.
To that level.
Right. So, because I know you're probably going to get to some of the questions that I might have, so I do want to try to let you get through your presentation. But some of this would have been avoided with the public making these comments and other things if we had gotten that message out sooner. So again, I'm going to call that we have a communication strategist that would have helped us get this message out, because once they got that in their hands, and some people do understand real estate, but once they got that in their hands, they were wondering, now are my taxes going to go up?
Right. The letter
and
does
a couple of other things. So if we would have communicated that better, that would have.
That's a point well taken. I think the letter comes out every year. It does explain that just because your assessment went up doesn't mean your taxes are going up. It doesn't take the sting out of somebody seeing, oh my goodness, that my assessment went up so much. But that's a point well taken about the communication in advance.
Well, Joanne, in your defense, it comes out every year, like you said, and I spent 14 years on the assessment review board and still don't quite understand everything. It's a very complex situation.
It is.
But you have to understand that when your assessments go up and you're assessed at 100% value, it may not be a bad thing. In fact, it's a good thing.
It's not.
And
it's
that's
not
why
at
I'm
all.
Glad you're here to explain it to everybody.
Yep. You know, I did put some MLS stats in here that I pulled. And what I did is I went from July 1 to June 30th, because that's our roll year, and I did it from 15-16, 16-17, and 17-18. And you can see that there were increases in values from all of those years. Now, these are not the stats that we use in determining our assessed values. We're working off of possibly a smaller scale of sales, because some of these will be including those non-arm's length sales like foreclosures and whatnot. But I did want to put that out there, and it'll be on the website whenever we can get that posted. So I'm just going to move on. The factors in determining taxes, we're really talking about two different issues. Mm-hmm. There's assessments and there's taxes. And the two are not the same, even though they have relation, they're not the same. So an increase in your assessed value doesn't necessarily mean that your taxes will go up. There are other factors that are the determining character of the taxes. The tax levy is the controlling factor. That is the most important thing. And that will be your job. That's something that this council will work on. You'll be reviewing the budget and setting a tax levy. You have your tax levy, then you have the total taxable values of all the properties in the city, and then with those two numbers, you derive your tax rate. It's a little more complex in the city because we have two different rates, but that's the simple formula. The assessments are determined by the assessor. The taxes are not determined by the assessor. People get upset because the assessment went up, but it is a good thing. It's not necessarily an increase in taxes. The taxes ultimately will be determined by this council and by the school board and by the county legislature.
But not tax rates.
Well, you're going to set the tax levy, and with that, you'll have your tax levy, and then you're going to divide the taxable value of all the properties into that rate to determine what the into the levy to determine what the tax rate will be.
Joanne, if you can just remind me, I'm not sure I have information here, but do you recall what our tax levy is for 2019? Is it 19904?
I think that was the 18 okay. levy. 19 oh. was
so
around
it's 20502. Is that correct?
What was it? 20. I think it was 20,000, maybe. 20,520.
Oh, is it 21?
It was 19 and change in 18, okay. And in 19 it was around 20, a little
yes.
over 20.
Okay. Great. Thank
yeah,
you.
There was a slight increase in the levy for the 2019.
Right, and I remember during the budget talks, we were very determined to keep that down.
And I think you mentioned another important piece that I don't want people to lose, is that the city of Newburgh isn't the only taxing entity for homeowners. It is also the school district. It is also the county.
It's the school and the county.
And the county, right. Yeah. And it's interesting because, and I'm glad Councilman Grice brought that up, because a lot of times people come to us and say our taxes are too high. Now, and we'll say, listen, the city doesn't get it all. You know, in fact, a little over 50% goes to the school district and a few percent go to the county. And then we get, you know, somewhere in the 40, 47 or 48% of your total tax liability for your home. And so, in fact, we got the superintendent coming on Monday to talk about the new budget proposal and also a, I think it's a $57 million bond. Bond for capital improvements with the schools. And so with that all being said, it's just, you know, a learning curve for a lot of us, myself included. And yeah, so we're not the only taxpaying tax collecting entity equation.
The school tax is the highest tax rate that we have.
And it's based on your tax base too. We have a lot of not for profit.
We do.
And that has, you'll see a difference in, if anybody read the record today, the story in the record, right. You'll see a house that's worth the same in the city of Newburgh as worth the town of Newburgh, and your taxes are about two-thirds less. And it's because of that, too. There's other things that come into factor. There's so many things that come into factor when you're figuring a tax rate and a tax base.
Now, one of the other elements that comes into the equation, and our city manager and I have been really putting our heads together on getting the data, right? We want a data analysis of all these different areas of where we can be improving and somehow get it onto a computer software program where we can actually visually see it in bar graphs or pie charts or something. When we talk about the percentage of homeowners in the city of Newburgh, at one point it was 30% to 70%. But we've had a record-breaking number of homeowners move into the city within the last year and a half to 2 years. So now we've seen that number change. Now there's 35% of our population in the city are homeowners and 65% renters, right? So looking at that ratio, and then of the 35% homeowners, we're trying to get our fingers on how many homeowners and even investment property owners not paying their taxes.
So hold on a second.
When we figure that number out, which when we say, okay, 50% of the 35, which are homeowners, aren't paying their taxes, or whatever the percentage of investment property owners not paying their taxes, how does that play into the city's revenue? And how does that play into the city's annual fiscal budget and what losses we have by people not paying their taxes on time in terms of how, if we have opportunities to lower taxes. So being on this city council since 2016, I remember at least one, if not 2 years, where we decreased taxes for homesteaders. And so there'll be more opportunities for us to decrease the tax liability for homeowners, particularly if we can get 80% or 70% of the people who do have homes and own those homes to pay their taxes on time. So we're looking at that data as well and doing a critical analysis of that data.
So I do want to add that I've also been requesting some data, as you know, and doing some data analysis myself. It's not really fully completed yet, but so far, according to my records, there's about 37% of our homeowners who are not paying taxes. And there's a couple of other things. So I'm working on that data with a few other people that I like to call nerds, and so we'll get that data. But the reason why we're looking at it is so that it could be more solution-based than just looking at the problem. But to Mayor Harvey's point, we do need all of our property owners to pay their taxes. Also, one of the things that Mayor Harvey and I have and others have talked about is having our non-for-profits doing something back for the city, even if it's just a service in lieu of taxes or something else.
You can't do that. You can't ask them. We have to get help from this at the state level, and I think we need to start talking to, you know, possibly Senator Skoufis and Assemblyman Jacobson to get us, you know, to help us and move in that direction to maybe apply a municipal service fee.
And right. Yeah, and this is going back to the taxes, with tax liabilities, Joanne or Todd Venning, our comptroller, one of the two, you may be able to speak to this. How does it impact from your perspective when you have either homeowners or investors that have investment properties in the city of Newburgh? When they're not paying their taxes, can any one of you, Todd Venning or Joanne, can you speak to how that affects the city?
I'll defer to Todd. I do not collect taxes. I don't see the tax bills. I do assessments.
You just do assessments.
I don't do taxes. So,
okay.
I don't know if Todd has that data available. So, Todd,
if people, let's say we got 35% homeowners in the city of Newburgh currently, right? And let's say 50% of that 35 does not pay their taxes on time. From a fiscal, an annual fiscal perspective, how does that affect us, Todd?
When you say impact the city of Newburgh, which impact are you looking for?
Like, how does it impact other homeowners that may be paying in terms of the tax rates and what the expectations are, and then also in terms of our budgetary, distribution of funds?
So just briefly, when people don't pay their taxes, that affects our revenue line. So when we bill our revenue, taxes are billed on the first or the second of the year in January, depending on what day it is. So when we don't receive those monies for taxes, it basically reduces revenue to the city, which obviously affects operations in future years because of fewer funds coming in. But if I could just back up for a second with a few points that were made. The council does set taxes by setting the levy. So I would be glad to explain that like later in more detail.
The rate.
Well, the rate is a function of dividing the levy over the full taxable assessed value.
It was out there that it was us that sets it. And it's not, it's a whole conglomeration of people, the legislature, the county, the school taxes. It's a whole, it's not us. We're not the only ones that say, okay, your taxes are going up $500 this year. It's a whole big thing that goes into one.
So I could definitely devote some time to that later if you all would like. But just to clarify a few items, when the council, you know, approves the budget and sets the levy, that actually does affect what the taxes will be.
Sure.
And the taxable rate. So the council does have the ability and actually factually does impact the taxes. Also, just want to clarify that last year, we actually did go over the tax cap by a very small amount. It's only about $57,000. And that's new information that we have that was not available. You were correct in the previous information that was presented.
Yeah.
But we have recently done an update since I was here, and we did exceed by about a very small amount. So it's still very close to the 2%. It wasn't anything major, but we did exceed by about 57,000. And just to your point, what's going to reduce the tax burden for people is once the levy is set, if there are more homes on the tax roll, that is what spreads it. It's not when people don't pay their taxes. When people don't pay their taxes, that impacts the revenue to the city. But what would reduce the taxes to an individual based on the levy is being able to divide that tax levy by more homes. So we have to get more individual homeowners and more investors, because 70% of the residents in Newburgh are renters and not owners. So with that in mind, you're going to be looking to...
Just for a point of clarification, and this came out of the Economic and Development, Mrs. Church's office, we were at a 30 to 70% ratio for many years 30% of the residents were homeowners, and then 70 were renters. Now, from my understanding, and Mrs. Church can clarify, we have 65% of our population renters and 35, correct?
Okay.
So in 2018, we probably had the highest amount of homes being purchased in 2018. Allie?
Yeah, that information comes from the census, and the census has adjusted the percentage to more towards 65. So
65% renters, 35, and that's what impacts the tax liability and hopefully drives it down. Right, Todd? Is that what you're saying?
So what I'm saying is that, yeah, you just need more properties off the tax roll, whether they're purchased by developers and developed for renters or whether individuals live in them, it's the same effect. Right. As long as we don't have the properties on our accounts,
right,
it's and
that,
good.
And that has been moving in the right direction. And also, as another point of important clarification, the zombie buildings. Some of us are going up to Harvard in another week and a half to work with, you know, the greater minds of Harvard College or Harvard University at the JFK School of Government in figuring out how we can even do better at getting rid of these abandoned buildings and getting them back on the tax rolls. And so that's those efforts are being made.
And just to point out, the tax-exempt properties, those actually impact the tax roll as well, because the more nonprofits and colleges and places that you have that cannot be taxed, that's going to impact. They're exempt. They're wholly exempt. So while it's good to have, you know, colleges, hospitals, and universities from a standpoint of economic development and being a part of the community, those properties do become wholly exempt. And with Newburgh only being 4 square miles, there's not really a lot of room for, hey, we're going to start expanding this way or that way.
All right. Can we move on with the assessment, please?
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Thank you. So, you know, I just want to make one point. You mentioned the newspaper article, and they had the tax rate wrong. They had information in there wrong. They put
a
picture.
What was in there that was wrong? Because
the tax rate for the city of
Newburgh. Yeah, the 53,000 per 1,000.
53.
No, that's not the tax rate. That they. It was a study that they did, and they created something called the effective tax rate. And the article didn't define the formula of what goes into the effective tax rate. But it did include, as one lump sum, your school taxes, your county taxes, and your city taxes. And the one of the takeaways from the article is what Todd just alluded to. One of the things that the article did say is that small villages and cities like the city of Newburgh, where the number of properties that constitute the tax base are limited, it's going to drive up your effective tax rate. So the category, the universe of properties that are not on the taxable rolls, your zombies, your non-for-profits, your religious corporations, whatever, the higher proportion that you have is going to drive up your effective tax rate. So what we really need to look at is what that formula is that the study created that yielded that 53% rate. And that was not in the newspaper. Yeah. Maybe online, it may be somewhere else, but it clearly was not in the newspaper.
Yeah, thank you.
Yep.
So I'm moving on to the two graphs, the two charts that I have here. It's the assessed values and tax dollars. And on the left is a blue chart that shows the equalized taxable assessed value from 2004 to 2018. These are the homestead values. And you can see that values were increasing from 2004 up to 2008. Values, assessed values were increasing. From on the right-hand side are the tax dollars that were paid. And so from 2005 to 2009, during that same period, tax dollars were going down as our values were going up. And then the opposite happened. We turned the corner from 2008, we went down 2009, and continued on the downward trend. However, tax dollars increased, respectively. So this kind of shows you that as our assessments go up, it does give us the room for our tax dollars, our tax bills, the tax amounts to go down.
Good.
Great.
So I just wanted to touch on the grievance process, because that's what we're up to at this time, according to our calendar. May 28th is grievance day. You can grieve your assessment. There is no mechanism within the tax law to grieve taxes. You can only grieve an assessment. You cannot grieve your taxes. Again, assessments are based on market value. So if you feel that your property is worth what the assessment is, then it's a fair assessment. If you feel that it would sell for more, it's still fair. If you feel that it's assessed higher than what your market value is, then there's something that we should talk about. And I welcome people to come to my office. I meet with people all day long. Call, set up an appointment, come in. I'll be happy to review your assessment. I'll be happy to review the information that we have on your property and make sure that it's accurate. But aside from that, you would still need to file RP 524, which is the complaint form that the state gives us. It must be filed and signed and provided, submitted to the assessor's office by May 28th. If you choose, we will set up an appointment for you to meet with the Board of Assessment Review. They will meet on the 28th between the hours of 4 p.m. and 8 p.m. at the Activity Center. It's a five-person panel, and as you know, Councilman Sophocles, they're all very fair. You know most of the people that are still on it. They're very fair. They'll listen. They'll ask questions, and they make good determinations. If you are not available to meet with the board on that evening, you can just submit your complaint form to the assessor's office. We will make sure they get all your supporting documentation and your complaint. They will make their determination when they reconvene, and you'll have an answer. So I think that's pretty much it.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for your efforts. Greatly appreciated. Moving forward from the engineering department, we have an agreement with CSX this evening to discuss impacts related to the replacement of the Walsh Road Bridge.
Good evening. As you know, the Walsh Road Bridge is currently in the design phase for replacement, scheduled to occur in approximately 2021. One of the portions of the design phase is what we call right-of-way incidentals. Right-of-way incidentals is the process in which the designer looks at the property surrounding where the bridge is or will be and determines ownership if the city doesn't own all the properties. During the right-of-way incidentals phase for the Walsh Road Bridge, we identified that CSX is an owner of property that the city may need to acquire or at least have access on while the bridge is replaced. This resolution is an agreement between the city and CSX Transportation that allows correspondence to take place where CSX will review submittals from the city to either acquire a portion of their property or for CSX to provide access during construction.
Great. Okay. Next item, we have traffic signal upgrades to the Master Federal Aid Local Project Agreement.
This is a resolution authorizing the city to enter in a local projects agreement with DOT, New York State DOT, for an Orange County Transportation Council funded project to reconstruct the traffic signals, curb ramps, and ADA curb ramps and crosswalks at the intersection of Broadway and Grand Street behind us, and then Liberty and Broadway also out the windows here. So these traffic signals that are currently in place are deficient. The poles that they're on are failing, and we need to remove the traffic signals from those poles. This project will reconstruct the traffic signals entirely.
When is that going to happen?
This is a federal aid funded project similar to the Walsh Road Bridge project, and there's a federal aid process that takes approximately 3 years.
So Jason, when they do that, can we paint the crosswalks Will that be done at the same time?
It will.
So
there'll be pedestrian, what we're proposing are pedestrian bump outs, ADA compliant curb ramps, and then pedestrian crossing signals as well.
Great.
Can I ask you a question in particular to one pole that looks dangerous? Right there in front of our building, 123 Grand, and across from 124 where the library and the Board of Education is, that pole is leaning with heavy equipment on it, with just a little of the caution tape around it that will not secure anything from happening.
So the poles in the city are generally owned by Central Hudson, but we could take a look at that and reach out to Central Hudson and alert them to that pole.
Okay, and that is...
And that's on Grand Street between the library and 123 Grand?
Yes, it's okay. Right in front of our building.
Okay.
Second Street, yes.
And Jason, really quickly, since we have you, before you step away from the table, there was an email from the DOT with concerns for Precision Pipeline, Central Hudson, doing gas line work on recently paved roads, particularly 9W, and there was supposedly a 5-year moratorium on any work that would go on once the DOT comes in and repave. You got any update on that?
So the email you're referring to was from DOT suggesting that the city adopt a policy similar to DOT's policy, that there's a moratorium on road excavations for 5 years after the city were to pave a road. That may work in rural areas or less urban areas, but typically in the city you have water main breaks, sewer main breaks, water service failures, and sewer service failures for private entities where there's no way around digging up the street to replace that private utility. So I don't think that would be feasible in the city, where you have a property owner who has a water service fail, and telling him that he can't replace that for 5 years is not really practical.
Well, there may be a way in the language where we can say, unless it's an emergency or extenuating circumstance.
There may be something that we, if my recollection is correct, I believe there was a municipality on Long Island that recently enacted a similar policy. I thought I saw something like that on the news. So if we could look at the state policy, maybe, if they would be willing to share it with us, I'll be happy to do a little research, and maybe we could come up with something that would minimize the disruption or facilitate more cooperation among the larger entities that want to get under the streets. Obviously, emergencies occur,
right.
But we need to have, if we're going to adopt a policy, there have to be objective and
fair
criteria as to when when there's an exception to the policy, and that's going to be the more difficult portion of it. But
right.
I wasn't aware of that email, so
yeah.
I can work with Jason and see if there's something that we can, as staff, come up with that we can, in good faith, recommend to the council.
Thank you.
Hey, Jason, quick question. In the traffic signal upgrades that are being discussed for the intersections you mentioned,
mm-hmm.
is there any mention of a turning signal as well?
There may be that the turning signal issue will be fleshed out during the design phase, the preliminary design phase.
Okay.
Yep.
Okay. Thank so I do want to put my wish list out there, and I'll have something coming, more data-driven, coming very, very soon. My wish list is that we take all of our streetlights away from Central Hudson.
Yep. I agree with that.
So I'll have something coming
Kipsey
soon.
Kipsey did it.
I'm working on it.
Yeah, okay. Kipsey did
okay.
it.
Okay.
Yep.
Make sure it has the costs attached
it
to it.
It does.
Thank you.
I have all the costs.
Yeah, there's grants. There are grants. And then that way we can do LED lighting and all.
It's coming soon. Soon.
To a theater nearby?
Oh, yes.
Near you.
Really have any illusions?
Thanks, Mr. Morris.
All right, thank you.
You're the best, man.
The next item on the agenda this evening, we are going to discuss the home rule request for police officer Samuel Keenan, which we are revisiting this year after doing so last.
Okay, so some of you who were on the council last June may recall that the city had passed, at the request of Mr. Keenan, a home rule request for special legislation allowing him to be moved from the 25-year retirement system to the 20-year retirement system. Unfortunately, that bill didn't get through the entire state legislature in the last session. Our current state legislators have introduced similar legislation for this session, and they have asked the council to pass a new home rule request for this purpose. So unless there's any questions, since it's already been passed once, I would recommend that you do so again.
Sure.
Yeah. Perfect.
Sure.
Thank you. Moving forward, we're going to now be discussing the fireworks contract for 2019, which will be a resolution authorizing myself to accept the proposal and execute a contract with Fireworks Extravaganza for the Firework 4th of July Festival in the amount of $10,000. Todd, any questions?
How many a year?
Yep. This is annual.
Yeah. My only side thought to that is let's make sure that our residents who would like to be vendors at that that event really know that full process, so that everyone's, as far as our vendors, that they're set up legally.
By all means, thank you.
Thank you.
The next item we have, we'll be discussing a leak detection grant with Orange County Water Authority. Wayne.
Good afternoon. So every year we do our full citywide leak survey. I've been speaking to the county, and I said I think it would be wonderful if the whole county would do it, or at least have a grant, and they did look into that and they started it. So there's up to $10,000. That's what we spend every year. I do have that budgeted, so if we do get this grant, then we wouldn't have to we can allocate those funds to something else.
So it's only 10?
Yep.
Wow. That's is that good?
That we do the whole entire city of Newburgh, including all of our private, so our, you know, our Mount St. Mary College, Ferry Crossing, all the whole entire water system we do for about 10 grand.
Wow, that's great.
Yep.
And again, how much have we saved since doing that?
Hundreds of thousands of dollars.
Yes. I knew that. I just wanted you to say it out loud. I do have, while you're sitting there, I do have one more question, which sure. Isn't related to this. Yep. It's about Browns Pond, because recently the Windsor went through a situation where their well had some PFAS and PFOAs in it. And then one of the conversations that someone told me was that the well is actually under Browns Pond or something. Can you speak to that?
So I believe Jason could probably help me with this, but you know, we've had some testing done. I forget the exact terminology, Jason, but we don't. The data states that it's not under the influence of groundwater, but we are obviously closely monitoring Browns Pond.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you. The next item, we will be discussing the purchase of 33 Ship Street.
Good evening. So this is a little different than normal. I'm actually presenting two different offers tonight, and I'll go through them and explain why. Our department's just looking for some advice moving forward on the difference of these two offers. 33 Ship Street is a small single-family home on the West End. It's in pretty horrible condition. It needs substantial renovation. We, as with the other properties, this is listed through River Realty, and we did put it out for a significant amount of time looking for an owner-occupant, finding none. So both proposals that I have before you are for investors. Both have indicated that they would like to rehab it and then sell it to an owner-occupant, making that generally even. So here's where the difference is. And again, it's been some intense debate internally, and so just, again, seeking advice from all of you. We were asking $84,900 for the price. We have one offer for $80,000 and one offer lower at $60,000, so a relatively significant difference in price. We asked both for best and final, And this is what we have. So the difference, however, is that the $80,000 offer, the higher one, has very limited experience renovating, and the lower one has pretty significant experience. So as we move forward towards some of these properties that need a lot more work, need a lot more attention, we want to manage both allowing new investors to come in and be able to invest in the community and help support the community, but we also want to do our due diligence to you all and to the city and make sure that these properties are done in a timely manner. Mm-hmm. Right. So at this point, you know, just willing to have conversation, more than happy to bring one of these offers forward on Monday, or we can bring more information back the next meeting, whichever is your preference.
Do you have any sense of how much they're actually going to cost to rehab?
Yes, I didn't see that. Both proposed similar prices, which is about the price of purchase, so between $70,000 and $80,000. Okay. For renovation. Both. So the person who is offering $60,000 has their renovation cost at $76,000, and the person who's offering $80,000 has their renovation cost at $78,000. So they have similar renovation estimates.
And so the one that you mentioned who offered the lowest, you think has more experience?
They have significant experience doing renovations in the city of Newburgh as well.
Mm-hmm.
And they're not going to flip it, they're going to rent it.
No, to clarify, both of them are planning on flipping it if they can. So to an owner-occupant.
I don't know.
Neither of them are ultimately interested in renting. We do not generally put an owner-occupant restriction on what we would call flips.
No, but to make money. I mean,
understood.
If they're doing it to flip, you know what that house
yes,
is probably worth
yes,
at full full value, maybe what, 170, 160?
Yeah.
So you're going to go through all that work to make $10,000? It doesn't make sense to me.
Yeah. Well,
understood.
Right.
Yeah, so I would say go with the higher.
I mean, and there's other options too. We can continue to put these on market for other things. We can take them off and look for other types of offers. But at this point, these are the two best offers that we have.
Tough call.
It makes sense if somebody was going to live in it,
mm-hmm.
but not to flip it because, I don't know, that's just my opinion.
So, Ellie, just so I understand, did you say that this is something that's different?
Generally, a couple things happen. We do best and final, and we get the prices very close, and then we can recommend someone, you know, who may have more experience or not. These are just this is a big delta in prices, and you know, again, it may be to Councilwoman Sophocles' point that $20,000 difference may be to that person, a more realistic.
And then they have to pay taxes.
Indeed.
Yeah. Okay.
Well, so using the tax conversation that we had earlier, right, if we just look at that, so currently, at least according to the 2019, obviously this would not be an arm's length sale.
Right.
So, you know, putting that into it, but in terms of if you're an investor, this is what you're looking at because this is what the market can bear. So according to the 2019, it is estimated for market value would be over $112,000. So that's at 100%. And last year, you know, full market value for the 2018, it was more or less around the same type of price. So this is, again, you know, just as an additional conversation about, like, what is your home assessed? What can the market bear? These are the different things that, you know, we talked about previously. So just wanted to interject that into the conversation.
So is there any, again, for our department, we're more than happy, and we've had this conversation with Todd, obviously, you know, does that, it should we value things like the offer price overall, you know, and that's certainly a way to sell real estate. The highest price is it, or should we look long-term towards things like experience in the community and doing renovations?
I think long-term and somebody who's experienced because, you know, we're taking a chance with this other person who doesn't have the experience.
And that's my personal opinion also. I always prefer people that are going to actually live in the house or have that experience here. So that's my preference as well.
Well, I mean, we obviously want homesteaders, but that's not always the case. So you get people that want to invest in our city, and we welcome that as well. Whether they're going to flip it or not, you know, that's really not to our discretion. but I noticed that you only put financials in this packet for one of the...
No, they're both in there.
They're both in there?
Yeah, and I have them here, too. I don't have extra copies, but I'm certainly happy to pass my folder.
No, we put the private owner development application for both owners in the packets.
Okay. I got to find it then. Okay.
I mean, I think in what I would say in terms of, you know, when we have these types of discussions about, I know, for example, that, you know, some residents who are here renting may not have either the patience, the time, the talent, right, to be able to go out there and hire their own contractor or be a do-it-yourselver renovator to be able to, you know, do some of these houses. So, again, it's all about, like, educating the public about what the market is, how much you can purchase a home when it's after it's been rehab, et cetera. So, to me, you know, the argument of just because it's not the straight owner already should not discourage us from those types of, you know, conversations. So how long did we advertise this home for?
So it was put out on March 21st. So it was put out for the 30-day look-see, and we got no interest from anyone other than investors.
March 21st of
2019.
I mean, I would say, like, I mean, again, this is part of the promotion, right? If you're interested and you're going to be the homeowner occupied, can we give it a little bit more time to see who else comes in? Because honestly, at the 88, less than 90 grand, it's a really great house.
Yeah, absolutely. And they are, just to clarify, we don't pull them from, you know, until we have a ruling from you guys. So if someone is interested listening or otherwise, owner-occupant is still available.
Great. Okay.
So what I'll do, it sounds like there's not a strong preference, and so maybe I can hold this until the next. I can hold it for 2 weeks. We can see if there's more owner, you know, with another call for owner occupants, and then we can move forward.
Let's go with the higher bidder, I say.
The higher bidder.
Yes.
I don't agree. I think we should hold it for 2 more weeks and see if we can get a homeowner in there.
Yeah. What's 2 weeks?
I mean, yeah, holding it 2 weeks is not. But
I've already said my preference. I want homeowners.
But if we don't get the homeowners in 2 weeks, I believe we should go with the higher bid.
We can present the higher bid in two weeks. Okay.
Yep.
Thank you.
So if you're listening to this, tell your friends, tell your neighbors, drive by 33 Ship Street, take a look at the property, and
nice neighborhood.
The next item this evening, we're going to discuss transfer of 140 Chambers Street, 27 Johnson Street, and 43 Johnson Street.
And I'm going to invite Lisa Daly, the chair of the Land Bank Board, to join me.
Hi, everybody.
Hi, Lisa.
So this is a transfer of 3 properties to the Land Bank. Again, 27 Johnson and 43 Johnson were properties that were taken strategically as part of something that the legal department has been working on. These were not taken in rem for tax foreclosure. These are properties where this is a way to tackle the zombie property issue, if you will. These are properties that have been, for all intents and purposes, abandoned. And so they were taken.
Two of them were taken pursuant to Article 19 of the Real Property Actions and Proceedings Laws, and that was for under the abandoned property that some of you may heard about attending NICOM trainings. The other one was an actual reverter where the city enforced its right of reentry and right of reverter.
Mm-hmm.
And so I'm going to let Lisa talk a little bit more about the programs that these are taken for, but 27 and 43 Johnson will go to the house-to-home rent-supported homeownership program, and 140 Chambers as well. Well, I'll let you.
Okay. I'm sure you're familiar with the house-to-home program. We're really, really working hard at the Land Bank to try to get more home ownership here in the city of Newburgh, and there's a lot of financial issues around people that really want to buy a home, generally credit scores and lack of enough of an income for a down payment. And the Land Bank isn't involved in how that works, but we know that it's years in the making. If you have never had much credit or have a terrible credit score, it's years to bring it up to where most lending institutions will consider you. So 27 and 43 Johnson are in that our original target area, and we've had a lot of success with Habitat and RUPCO in that area, and so it would be a good fit to continue to really fill out those blocks with lovely homes. 140 Chamber Street is, there's a lot of damage. We haven't done any environmental testing yet, but we expect that both asbestos and lead will be an issue. So that's, we really just want to spend the two to get back into house and home. And the third, probably looking at working with Habitat. We'll see. Yep, that's so. Any questions about them? Anything we can tell you?
No.
Thank you. The next item, we will be discussing the release of restrictive covenants for 130 Johnson Street.
So this is a housekeeping item. This property was conveyed with the city's right of reverter in 1995. It was subsequently sold to a couple of different property owners over time, despite the deed covenants. It's now being sold again, and the title company that's being asked to insure for this sale had identified the covenants, requested that they be released. The statute of limitations for enforcement has expired, and I'm recommending that you release the unenforceable covenants and clear the title going forward.
The next item, we have a release of covenants at 53 Bencard.
So this one is actual completion and compliance with the city's deed covenants. The city sold the property in June of 2018. The property has been appropriately renovated. It has no code violations. There are no open permits. It has a valid certificate of occupancy for a two-family dwelling, and it is and the owner is looking for a release of the covenants, and the staff is recommending that you release the same.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Satisfaction of judgments for 260 Liberty Street.
260 Liberty Street, this is the property that the city had the emergency stabilization, and the city sold it to the Moores, who are dedicated to restoring this particular property. Title has already closed, but the title company has asked the city to come in and release a series of code enforcement judges that the city had obtained against former owners of the property. When the city took title to the property in tax foreclosure, theoretically those interests would have been cut off, but the title company, out of an abundance of caution, is asking the council as a housekeeping item to actually issue a discharge that would be recorded in the title records, and I'm recommending that you do so.
Oh, yes.
Satisfaction of the mortgage for 184 Broadway.
184 Broadway was a Newburgh Community Development Agency mortgage that was issued in 1998 for $15,000. This particular instrument does have an amortization where a loan converts to a grant if the property is held in the appropriate ownership for the requisite period of time, which is 10 years. So in this case, the entire proceeds of the loan would have converted to a grant. The property owner has held the property for the requisite period of time. The property is now being sold to a third party, and the buyer, seller, and their title company are asking the city to issue the satisfaction of record, and we're recommending that you do so.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Item number 16, regarding reverter settlement for 56 Bencard Avenue.
The This is a reverter action that Jeremy Kaufman commenced on behalf of the City of Newburgh. There is a proposed resolution, which I believe Jeremy has discussed with you previously in executive session. So we're asking you to actually ratify the terms of that proposed settlement. The property owner will have a particular period of time to complete the renovations, being until October 11th of 2019. As part of this settlement, we will hold the deed and transfer documents in escrow, and if the property owner does not succeed to complete the renovation, title those documents will be recorded and city will automatically take title. So that's the just a little bit of a difference here. Mm-hmm. So we're asking you to ratify that settlement.
Item number 17, we have an updated contractor list for the lead line replacement grant.
So most of you are familiar with our lead line service replacement program grant, which the city accepted in January of 2018. The staff has developed a process for qualifying the plumbing contractors who are authorized to do the work. Periodically, we have new contractors who've come in and other contractors who have declined to continue the work. So as just a housekeeping item, we would like to update that list so that we have a valid list of approved contractors for those properties that are still in the hopper for whatever funding is left to be available.
Moving forward, we have good sports equipment donation. Derek couldn't be here with us this evening. This is an annual donation that the city receives. All we have to do is pay for shipping and handling. Good sports equipment is kind enough to donate a wide range of different sporting equipment for the recreation department to use, whether it's jerseys, sneakers, basketball, soccer balls. So we will be moving forward with that, obviously, with your approval as well, too. Mm-hmm. Item number 19, Protect Our Courts Act, at the request of Councilwoman Monteverde, offering a support resolution.
Thank you. And this is something that I think, after passing the municipal ID resolution, that, obviously comes natural that we should do this because of what has been happening around us. I think in particular in Middletown, ICE was in the courthouse and there made it an arrest after somebody had attended court. So this is something that obviously we need to do, protect our courts and make sure that it's safe to go to court for our people who are undocumented, who are simply going to court to resolve a ticket or domestic issue. So I hope that everybody's in agreement and we can pass this resolution on Monday.
Yeah,
thanks.
So I do want to add that I'm 100% in agreement. I believe that just because someone is undocumented doesn't mean that they're illegal. That's not an equivalent. And if they're going to court to take care of whatever that situation is, that they should just be going to court for that situation. We shouldn't have people, I hate to use that term, but I can't think of a better one. We shouldn't have ICE agents, ambulance chasing our.
What they're doing is stalking, and I'm calling them the Gestapo these days. And people are living in fear, and that's not okay. And we, need to do. I feel like it's my duty to do whatever I can, and I hope that as a community, we're all in support of making sure that everybody is not living in fear and that they feel protected in our community.
Yeah, and I think I would add that, sort of the safety and interaction between ICE agents and communities, particularly here in the city of Newburgh, goes beyond even the walls of a court. On Tuesday, and I think probably some of you guys will be getting calls as well, ICE agents were in the city of Newburgh. They picked up an individual on DuPont. And so the harassment and the chase is taking place even outside of court walls. And I think individuals and the communities need to know what your rights are. In the same fashion that we have teach-ins about police and community relations, we need to also have teach-ins about interactions with ICE as an agency and what individuals' rights are. You know, there's two types of warrants. You have to be served a warrant. Regardless of your status in this country, you do have human and individual rights that cannot be surpassed.
Right. And I believe that it's, just so everybody's aware, it's a particular warrant that's called a judicial warrant that's signed by a judge.
Yeah, also just to add to that briefly, what people don't realize is that when you read the United States Constitution, there are constitutional rights not only for citizens, there are constitutional rights for people in the United States, and I think that that clarification needs to be made aware. I mean, made known to all individuals that even though you may be undocumented, all we got to do is read the fine print in the United States Constitution. Their rights are protected whether you are a citizen or you are not.
Thank you. The next item, at the request of Councilman Grice, we have a paper carryout bag fee.
So I'll speak to this really quickly, and then if anyone needs backup data, of course I can provide it for them. On in March, in April, Governor Cuomo signed the legislation for reusable bags. However, it is up to the city and the counties to adopt that. When we had County Legislator Kevin Durian Lujan here, and we asked him a few questions, one of the topics that came up was how were we going to enforce it with this resolution, because it's going in front of them on the 28th with this support letter. It is asking them to adopt it, and then along with the 5-cent fee, and they'll be better able equipped to do that. And then with the 5-cent fee, we will get a portion. I believe it's 40%.
So let me just clarify just a couple of things so everybody understands. So there, in the state budget for next year, there is a prohibition on plastic carry-out bags. With certain exceptions, you won't be able to go into the grocery store or other retail establishments and get a plastic bag to take your products home with you. It's being banned in the state, second state in the nation to do that. As part of that state legislation, the state has allowed counties and cities to impose a 5-cent fee on reusable paper carryout bags. So there's three basic types of bags that we're talking about. There's the plastic bags. When you go to the grocery store now, you ask paper or plastic. We're talking about the plastic option. That's going to be banned. Paper carryout bags, there is an option now for localities, being the counties and the cities, to impose a 5-cent fee on those bags. So if you go to the grocery store without a reusable bag and you need something to carry your items home in and you have to get the paper bag, the county or the city could impose a 5-cent fee. In order, so the county and the city, if this, they do it simultaneously, then the county fee wouldn't apply in the city. Now, the fee is assessed by the retailer, and the retailer collects that money at the time, at the point of sale, and they remit it to the state Department of Taxation. State Department of Taxation collects it as part of the sales tax. A portion of that money goes to state fund. Another portion of that money comes back to the locality that implemented the fee for the express purpose of helping their community members buy the reusable bags so that more people will be able to use reusable bags and not have to rely on the paper carryout bags. And there is also language in that legislation that says that the priority for using those proceeds for the purchase of reusable bags in the community should be given to low-income and distressed communities. So what in discussing this with Councilman Grice and some other members of the community, we think that a countywide local law is a little easier to manage than having one in the city. if we adopted our own paper bag fee here in the city of Newburgh, we would also have to establish the program for using, collecting those, to getting those funds from the state comptroller, and then establishing the program to help people buy the reusable bags. If the county enacts their own local law, the city of Newburgh does not act, the city would be subject to the county local law, and the county would be responsible for that reusable bag program, but there would have to be a priority in that usable bag program for low-income and distressed communities, of which I think the city of Newburgh would stand in high priority.
Right.
So this resolution is to support the county's efforts to establish a local law for that reusable paper bag fee.
Okay.
Terrific. Moving forward, we have a donation of trees resolution authorizing myself to accept just that from Mid-Hudson Subaru. This is coming from the Conservation Advisory Council.
Councilwoman Jeannie Abrams, who's now on the Conservation Advisory Council, has secured a donation from Mid-Hudson Subaru of, I believe, 12 trees. The plan is to coordinate with Horizons of the Hudson and plant those trees in Tyrone Crab Park. We are currently reviewing where in Tyrone Crab Park those trees can be planted without engaging the services of an archaeologist. And thanks to the city engineer and our interim director of planning and development, we have some ideas. Former Councilwoman Abrams has asked the city to accept those the donation.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay.
The next item under ordinances, we will be discussing the municipal ID fee.
As a follow-up from adopting the local law, previously I had included with your materials an ordinance to establish a fee for the application and issuance of those municipal ID cards. The ordinance that I had previously submitted to you had some proposed fees in it. We had some discussions at prior meetings in which you indicated to me that the fees that I had proposed might be a little too low, and we should be more consistent with the other cities in the area who have already adopted local laws and started implementing their fees. So the ordinance that's now here in draft, and with your permission, I could move it into a final form. The charges would be $15 for an adult card, anybody over 18 and under age 60 and under age 62. It would be reduced to $7 for anybody who's under 18 or over age 62, veteran or disabled. There would be a renewal or replacement fee of $5. And of course, the legislation does contain a waiver provision. So if somebody was economically distressed and unable to come up with the fee, if they could express why or explain why it would be a challenge for them, there is a way for the clerk and the manager to waive that fee. So we're looking towards implementation, and this would be another piece that would move us closer to implementation.
So thank you, Michelle, for that hard work. So are we still looking at trying to roll this out in July?
We are working diligently. We had a meeting earlier this week. We have identified a vendor.
Okay.
We're looking to lock in the funding and order the equipment.
Excellent.
And once that's in place, I think we'll have a better idea as to how soon we'll be able to roll out. But we are trying to push it as quickly as we possibly can.
Thank you so much for that.
Thank you. Last item this evening, up for discussion at the request of Councilwoman Rayford, who's been doing terrific work with organizing a parade later on this summer. We will be adopting and creating a proclamation honoring Sadie Talley for this parade, and this has been previously discussed among the council, but we just need to go through some procedural items so that we can make sure to honor her accordingly.
Thank you. I do want to just talk about this because it's been on the table, in which I don't understand why it keeps coming forward, in which I have submitted the information, the bio on Sadie Talley, November, and it came to a vote in December, I believe it was the 10th. But I would like to have a proclamation written for Sadie Talley, stating, hoping that it will come from the city, council declaring her as a legend of the city of Newburgh and honoring her in this capacity, dedicating the African American Pride Parade and Festival in her name, and we will call it the Sadie Talley Day. And it is to be held the second weekend in June of every year, forthcoming and or the duration throughout time. That's what I would like to discuss tonight. I must say that she is a legend here in the city of Newburgh that is still living. She's a phenomenal woman. This is the mother of our Tiambe Carter, who has done an enormous amount of work with the community, the African American community, the Latino, community. She worked with everybody, and she continues to work, and she's at the age of 85. So if anybody wanna comment.
I'm just a little confused because I thought we had already voted and approved this.
Yes.
We had done so. The parade date has changed a few different times. We have also created a certificate. However, if we were to do so after the parade, is it now August, correct? August 4th, I believe?
No, it's still June 8th and through 9th.
Yeah, that's the week after Illuminated.
Okay. Well, then we will be sure to act accordingly then.
So I think the council's understanding was that the parade was going to be dedicated in her name and that the appropriate citations, it being a proclamation and whatever, would be issued at that time. But Councilwoman Rayford has brought this onto the table again to take care of the proclamation and all the other preliminaries that she's just mentioned. For the council meeting and the city council's approval on Monday so that those documentations can be written or typed and drawn up and delivered to her on Mother's Day or Mother's Day weekend.
Okay.
And I definitely support any and every effort that Councilwoman Rayford is making to do this dedication and give this proclamation and support.
That is Sunday. Shady. You know that, right?
Right.
Yes.
Oh, that's right. So
it's just Monday.
So she may
Sunday.
Right. So she may need that to be typed up and so on. So there's no vote. Right.
Yeah, tomorrow we have to be realistic, Mayor. I mean, are they going to be able?
You don't need a resolution to adopt a proclamation.
We don't need a resolution to do that. Right.
Proclamation's a proclamation.
So that can be done tomorrow, hopefully. But what I'm saying is that I just want to put out for the record that I support this because Sadie Talley is and was and will always be a pillar in this community and a legend. CPR. I mean, when I first moved here as a teenager, she was the first person my pastor told me to go see. You need to go see Sadie Talley. She's got some work for you. She's going to put you to work in some community service. And so I've always been, and she's always invited me to various different events that she has been a part of, and I'm in support of it, so.
Yes, I am too.
Terrific.
Well,
we'll be certain to get this information to you tomorrow.
Thank you.
Do I now have a motion to go into executive session?
Before we do that motion, I mentioned it to other city council members, Mr. Donut, and I thought it looped you into the conversation. I wanted to do if not a city council proclamation, at least a mayoral proclamation and a key to the city to Mr. Joe Alvarez. For the hard work and dedication and the community service work, particularly for the kids that he's done year after year after year in the city of Newburgh with the back to school, book bag, cookout.
So
stuff
are we doing
in the bus.
That like the next work session? It'll be on the agenda.
So, yeah, so I mean, he too wanted to try to do something for the Mother's Day.
Oh, come on.
But that may be, and if, you know.
Today's Thursday.
Yeah, so if that's something that we may have to move to the end of the month meeting.
It's more realistic to move it to the end of the month.
Okay. I'm fine with that. And then I know there are two other individuals that work very closely with Joe Alvarez, and I would recommend that they be recognized with certificates of recognition. So that's what I'm proposing for the end of the month. And if any other council members would like to support that effort, please let me know, or if I am on the island alone with...
No, you're not alone. I support that as well. Mr. Alvarez, as we know him as Florida or Flo, he has done a spectacular job with our community, with our youth, with families, period. And I believe he should be recognized. And there was a time when it was critical in the city of Newburgh when it came to the election, where couple council people try to scare him up, but he stayed the course. And Joe, we thank you for hanging in there. God bless you.
So I have to go back through my notes, but I thought we had already recognized, so we're doing it differently. We're not, because we had recognized, unless I'm like shadow boxing and going back to the future, we are Newburgh and Joe. Didn't we do that?
Not since I've been on the city council.
Not that I'm aware of.
Never.
Okay.
No. Yeah, and
I thought that Councilwoman Holmes had done that.
If she did, I know it wasn't since 2016.
Is there any way to go back and check, or?
Yeah, I'll go back.
We can go back and do some. I know we didn't. I didn't do a. I don't recall doing a resolution for her. So it may have been that there was a presentation, but I don't recall. Sitting here, I don't recall that.
And in my conversation with him,
he would know.
Yeah, 2 days ago, he said this has never been done for me.
Okay.
And I said,
not only that, we have a new mayor and we have new council.
Right. So I think it's appropriate, and
No, yeah, completely.
Yeah.
Being to a lot of his events, it's the Christmas one, there were so many kids here that had nothing, and they walked out of there with bags and bags of things. And even the backpack giveaway at the park is packed, and kids came and ate. They came and took backpacks home with them. They had all their school supplies they needed. And for those reasons alone, I'm for it.
Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah, no, Joe's a good guy. The only thing that I ask is that maybe we have this conversation not in public and kind of communicate before.
Sure.
So that
I
we could discuss it amongst ourselves, maybe.
I thought I did a text message.
Oh, you did?
Yeah, I did a group text.
Oh, that's
text.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Text message.
I don't mind a public conversation. I mean, I think it's fine.
Right. Yeah.
Just bugging me. Like, I swear. I either, like, you know, had a deja vu moment because I specifically remember seeing him standing there and we presented something, but okay.
I think I just want to be clear what the process is. Do we just throw a name out? Or?
We don't have a process.
We don't have that.
And I know I've been reading the New Orleans one for street naming.
To my knowledge, there has never been a development of a process or criteria for either street
there
naming.
There should be a write-up or
something.
Or
any type
criteria.
Of other honoraria.
And so that's what I was
I feel like
to
we
go
do
back.
It all.
And again, that's
freely.
Something that I also feel shouldn't necessarily come solely from staff. I feel like that's something that really does cry out for the input of the elected officials and other community members to determine what the process and the criteria should be for how you honor various and sundry people who work for your community.
Right. Yep. And so that's the same thing that I was going to ask for, barring these two situations that we have currently, that we really do need to put a process in place.
I agree.
Because then it becomes, it can have the appearance of a slippery slope because someone did a favor for us or something else.
Yeah.
When it comes to Joe, Florida, I call him. I've known him for a very long time.
He didn't give me a book bag.
And, you know, I volunteer at almost all of his events. So I do think he's deserving, but I think that moving forward, we really do need to have a process. So if we can all just put a hold on the next person until we get a process in place. I don't want to call it a moratorium, but if we could put a hold on honoring people until we have a process in place, I think that'll work. Because then it's clear to the community.
I mean, we were in that. I mean, we have a moratorium on street naming.
Yep, we do. But again, you have to, I think you need to identify that not only just the process, who gets nominated, but the criteria by which those nominations come in.
Exactly.
So what types of community service, what kinds of contributions, what kind of, you know, so there should be some, I mean, I can help you flesh out overview.
You have done this so many times, Michelle. Just in my short stint here as a board member, like, honestly,
we still have the New Orleans resolution thing.
But also, I want
to
say,
I would like to say something, because going back almost 4 years now, when I had mentioned Newburgh Zion Lions, the park at Gidney Avenue to be named after a particular person, which was my husband, which has done a phenomenal job for 25 years with the basketball, keeping these youth off the streets from 5 p.m. to 11 o'clock, and they tap on our doors 2 o'clock in the morning. We feed them, clothes, and we do it all. And for this to be said that there's no process, what happened when the ball dropped in my lap and nothing went forward? It's like, oh, you're on the council, you can't do that. Why? Because he's my husband. It's not fair.
Right. So I wasn't here at that time, and, you know, I can't speak to what happened then.
About your process,
but moving forward, I think that we should. And I think that moving forward, it would take into account those things, and we definitely could honor Mr. Rayford for all of that hard work that he's done. But then it's clear to the community, and it's clear to us, and it's not the, and then there wouldn't be any mention of you being, oh, it's your husband or your wife, because there's a clear process and that person fell into it regardless of who they're related to.
So there's a number of policies and procedures that the city's currently analyzing and reviewing, one of which is a communications policy. This will obviously be added to that list. We are going over everything and making sure that everything's crystal clear for all who are impacted
by
it.
Let me say this, because I have nothing against protocols and processes and procedures, but, you know, sometimes we get the paralysis of the analysis, and sometimes we create things that aren't quite necessary. And to be very frank, in past practices, if a council member has proposed that someone be honored, right, someone be recognized for their community service work, in the 4 years that I've, well, three and a half, four, whatever, that I've been here, I've never seen the city council deny those proposals or those requests, because all those individuals that come before this table have diligently earned that proposal or that you know, prospect of being recognized and honored. It's just like the gentleman, John Hess, who was here 50 years of service in our water department. You know, we didn't have a process for that, and I don't think there was a need for a process for that.
Well, I disagree. I think you do need a process, because, you know, you just, especially for employees, you know, it's something that you have to adopt, because one employee might feel like, hey, I've been here, you know, 20 years, and I've not even gotten a handshake or whatever. Congratulations for, you know, doing 20 years. It's just how you recognize people, and I think it makes it easier to, you know, have a process in place. It's easier to follow, or criteria, at least.
I think the ideal of having a process in place is just a smokescreen for roadblocks and for prohibitors.
I disagree with that 100%. I'm not talking about a roadblock. I'm really trying to
Well, we function without a process in the 4 years that I've been here.
But you don't function.
And it's
you
not
fight
even,
over it.
No,
you,
we don't.
I haven't seen it.
Councilman
Rayford is upset because her concerns are not being addressed for whatever reason.
But Michelle,
no one has been recommended
as far as my tenure on this council to be recognized for community service, and that hasn't happened.
So, can I say something?
Everybody, you have argued. I've observed it.
I think we get the paralysis of the analysis, and we put roadblocks and we put prohibitors in front of a process that, in past practices, has already worked.
I just want to say that it was mentioned
because I mentioned it with the former council members. To where it did fall, the ball fell in my lap, to where Mount St. Mary's Church at this current moment has petitions so that that can happen. And they will be bringing it to the council. And this has been taking place for 2 years. So I don't know how many signatures
they got. And honestly,
but yes,
every request that's come into play, 75% of the requests that have come up over the last 4 years, I've carried the ball for everybody. And all I'm suggesting is that there's a way to do it so that you don't have to worry about who's actually going to do the work and who do I have to see and who do I have to find.
Exactly.
Okay.
Exactly.
You need a process, for God's sakes.
The only thing that I would add to this is that, again, just like in the past conversations when this pops up, it should be a happy discussion that we have.
Right.
We want to recognize individuals from our community.
That's my point.
But instead it turns into this. And then I always make the request, Michelle, can you recirculate that New Orleans thing, right? And, you know, it's I feel for everybody around the table with the frustration. So I hope that before the end of 2019, we can actually move forward and having happy conversations when it comes to recognizing, you know, members of the community. And we do have the process. We just have to say yes to the process.
Okay.
Fair enough.
Noted. Do I have a motion to go into executive session?
I make it.
Second. All in favor?
Aye.
All right. All right.